So I will go slowly in case people are joining a little later.
So this is about the, although the time says it's a time series, this is indeed a panel series. So and as the title indicates, we're going to study the non-stationarity persistency in the distribution, time series of the distribution. So it's represented by densities. So I'll give you some overviews of the research in this area. What's involved here may be new for you, to some of you. And then I'll walk through the statistical precision and isotype fields. And those are all going to be done pretending that we know the true densities. And then I'll tell you about how, what is really indeed we have to estimate the densities when we don't have when you don't know true densities. And then I'll talk about the NPR applications, the pre-NPR applications, and I'll talk about upfront and toward the end, two applications that are already included in the paper. One is on the time series of income distribution, and the second one is the stock income distribution over time. And then toward the end, I'll also talk about the new empirical example, which is of the temperature, time series of temperature densities over time. So that is not part of this paper, but I think it's a nice application for this topic, so I'll talk about that. And then I'll show you the simulation, the components of our new test here. So again, I'll show you as basically, we want to study how things change over time, not just by looking at mean. I mean, often when you have income data, people look at, and people want to ask general questions like this, whether income inequality has been increasing, whether things are getting better in terms of income disparities. So in that kind of cases, people want to ask whether volatility, right, the variations in the income distribution is going up or down. Or if you're interested in global warming, we're interested in whether or not average, or whether or not there is a tendency for the temperature to continue to grow. And those kind of questions people are interested in, but lack of any better alternatives, people are not taking the average. If it's income distribution, you take the cross-sectional aggregate, right? Average. Each time, so you have one number, then you can get time series, one time series. And people have been using linear root tests and other things to see how persistent they are. And if it's persistent, what you're saying basically is if the income was rising or temperature was rising, it is more likely to be rising again in the next period. That's what persistence means. What's going to happen tomorrow is going to be very close to what's happening now. So if you were on an increasing path, it's more likely than not you will be on the increasing path. So whether it's global warming or whether income inequalities, those are certainly very important questions people in policy making are interested in. And what I'm saying in the paper is that instead of looking at one number like mean or variance, which is just one aspect of the distribution, instead of looking at just that in each period, looking at the whole distribution will give you much better ideas so that you can and give much better answer about the persistence that we see. So these are the two examples. You can look at the panel data and then look at the density distribution across the cross-sectional units, or you can take the high frequency data, say time series, very ultra high frequencies, and then you look at reasonable period of time, say 1 month, and then you can estimate the monthly spatial distribution using high frequency data, say 1 minute per day. And then you can study what I said, like the evolution of those time series properties in the distribution. So all along in this paper, I'm really going to be using the cross-sectional panel other distributions I have in mind when I will be motivating this research.
So this is the picture that I wanted to show you. So this is actually what's estimated. So I had data from 1994 to 2010, and each month, I have cross-sections of individual earnings, more than 10,000, which is enough for me to estimate density. So I have time series of individual, the income densities now. I mean, you can see that they're certainly not changing. I mean, they're changing over time. So I think we have a perception that density is deterministically given for a random variable. It's there, and that's the way, especially if you have a string stationarity and you have a time invariant density. So they have the same density, but it's clearly time invariant. It's not constant, right? It's not invariant over time, it is changing. Now, you can look at it more closely if you take the time average of these densities. So we have, for instance, in this case, we have about 222 monthly densities. You can certainly take the average of the density, you have average density, and you can imagine the deviation from the time average of the densities, and that is what's given here. So this is the demeaned densities, and you can see that they are drastically, it is drastically illustrated that densities are not constant over time. They are changing over time, and then if they are changing randomly, then there shouldn't be any systematic pattern, right? It should be going up and down, and there shouldn't be any patterns. But as you can see, this is far from randomly fluctuating around its mean, time series mean, and it is not. And that obviously represents there is a persistency in the distribution. If there is clearly it's not random fluctuation. There is a serial dependence. There is a serial dependence in the distributions. And serial dependence means what happens in the past matters for what's happening in the future. And then we like to study, but this is not just one characteristic of the distribution. It could mean is only one aspect of the distribution. Variance, kurtosis, all of them are just one single aspect. But what we see in this picture is the dependencies, persistence in the whole distribution. And we like to study what's the source of this persistency, what characteristics of the distribution really is causing us and giving us the persistence patterns that we are observing. And that is really our point of interest. Okay, we want to understand beyond and above what people conventionally have done, which is people just look at mean or variance, and we're going to look at whole distribution and see that how they change. And the second example is a Stapleton distribution, S&P 500 index, and we got 1 minute tick data. So what each identify the source of persistence. So this is the object of our interest. So obviously, this picture is clearly demonstrates the, confirms the style aspects that we know about the stability distribution, the income distribution. Obviously, you saw Faraday. Faraday, when I say Faraday, and the piping, especially the stability distributions, you see in my case. And then also, there are substantial skewness. And the time varying moments, you can see that if you see it, if you use the time varying density to estimate mean, and each time means different, variance is different, the moments are different, but also moments are depending on past as well. So that there are serial dependencies in the means, those are the things that we people have already noticed. I'm not the first person who noticed this. It's been noticed by many people and reported as a skyline survival. And obviously, the implication is that normal distribution, which we love to use because of its simplicity, is no longer applicable. It's just not good enough. We don't mean fat tails and high peaks, those are far away from being normal. And on top of that, obviously, looking at only two moments, mean and the variance. If you have a mean, that's good enough, right? Mean and variance completely characterize the distribution. But since now that we're not normal, first two moments just not enough. And the problem is the moments, like mean and variance, they're dependent on over time, but the dependence structure is not obvious. It is complicated. So anyway, this so people knowing all this, people try to get out of it. So a lot of efforts have been made historically. And people at the beginning try to get out of it, making some more realistic parametric assumptions. Like state operations, use the student T, normal inverse Gaussian, and the many others are used in actually in the literature to accommodate those stylized facts. The problem is there's no such a thing as perfect parameterization. Nothing is going to be perfect, right? So whatever you do, it's going to capture some aspects but not all, so it's imperfect. And moreover, once you move from normal to realistic family of distribution, things can get very quickly complicated. So these are the examples of parametric algorithms made in the literature. But of course, you can do non-parametric approach to this problem. So you will be using data-dependent adaptive shape with no parametric restrictions. So there's no limit if you take this route to allow the distribution to change. But the problem, you have more flexibility, but the problem is it's difficult to estimate non-parametrically. And moreover, once you go in non-parametrically, now you're dealing with infinite dimensional objects, right? And then now we want to introduce dynamics, right? Dependencies, serial dependencies over time. Introducing dynamics for these infinite dimensional objects, such as densities, is not trivial. But we're going to try, but there has been some methods in this and in the literature, stationary functional time series models, but they are all done in stationary. So stationarity means one way or another, it is more regular, quickly coming back to the mean type of persistency, which is different from what we see in finance and macro. But in this standard stationary cases, there's statistically regular functional time, stationary loss, and there is also auto-regression in stationary case and functional regression too, but they are all done in stationary case, so they cannot generate the type of persistency that we just saw in the pictures, like those income density time series and also stock returns. So those theories developed, they are useful, but cannot explain, be used to explain that kind of persistence that you saw in the picture that I showed you. So what this paper is trying to do, so we are trying to analyze persistency, which I'm calling non-stationarity. Stationary versus non-stationarity, and the non-stationarity is really capturing the persistency. We're going to analyze, and then those non-stationarity or persistency, severe form of persistency that we see in the time series density representing state distribution. So what we're going to be doing, since the, as you clearly saw that
So we are modeling them by assuming that they are random elements of the Hilbert spaces, Hilbertian random variable living in this. I'm going to be more specific about. And then we're going to use the functional time space model to fit this density, which is living in a Hilbert space. And by doing so, now we can analyze persistence in a much more general way. We don't have to restrict ourselves to look at only average, cross-sectional aggregates, or intra-period average, and then look at the just mean. But as soon as you're looking at aggregates, cross-sectional aggregates, or intra-period average, you're declaring that I'm only looking at the mean. But we did it, historically we've done it because we didn't have any better way of analyzing intersectionality. But at least, first order, if you look at the mean and to see where it goes, it'll at least tell you whether the mean is persistent, if it's in the rising path or the decreased path, things like that. But we're going to be able to do much more, not just mean, but variance, kurtosis, but any other distributional characteristics that you can be creating. This paper is just, what we're going to be doing is we're going to provide a framework where you basically have a tool to analyze time series of densities. And once you have a density, there are a lot of things that you can do. Okay? So I'll give you one example how you may measure persistency in the moments, for instance. So you can say that, well, what's the proportion of this mean function living in non-stationary subspace? I.e., you can say that how persistent the mean function is, how persistent the volatility is. So instead of saying that they have unit roots or not, you can say more accurately, more precisely, and you will see all this paper. Then the question is, we have to identify potential unit roots. And of course, unit roots, it's a matter of convenience. You have to model persistency, and the unit root is the most convenient thing that we know to model persistency, right? Unit root process is extreme form of dependence, right? Tomorrow is nothing but today plus some random fluctuations, right? So the unit root is a very convenient way of modeling persistency. But what we do, we identify unit roots, but the unit roots are used in different ways so that you're not dichotomously saying you have a unit root or not. But the unit root will be used to define non-stationary subspace. Because you're going to view, as I said, the density is going to be viewed as a random element living in a Hilbert space. And then I'm going to identify number of unit roots, so that is going to define what's called unit root subspace. And then other ones, the remaining ones, will be stationary subspace. So whenever you have a function, such as mean function, or variance function, then you can project that onto, that functions are also a member of Hilbert space. So you can project them onto subspaces, and you will see later how you can define unit proportion of the functions. And that unit function will tell you a priori some information about persistence. So anyway, those potential unit roots are identified using functional principle we'll be able to test how many unit roots are there using the generalized eigenvalue of the estimates and the variance of them. So I will find all this in those. So I'll give you, I know I threw at you a lot of things and probably you may have some questions to you. So let me give you some technical background. And then with that background, I'll talk about our model, functional time series model. Pretending that I know the densities, I have the densities, and then I can develop statistical procedure and theories, and then allow to have estimated densities instead of unknown true densities. But that's how we're going to move on. So basically, this is what I'm talking about. So you have a random element defined from the sample space to the range, and here this is the Hilbert space, but Hilbert space is general. The one that we're doing is actually the generalization of what we know. If you have a function g, it is a random variable, and h here is nothing but a real line. The random variable is nothing but a function from sample space to real line, to define. And if you have a vector, random vector, then the edge, the liberal space here is not going to find an exponential or a vector space. And if you have a general density, like function valued elements, then H is a space of squared integral functions. So here, this is also going to be limited. So my H Hilbert space here is going to be added to space of squared integral functions. And then the mean and the variance. So mean is the expectation and variance operator of random Hilbertian random variables. This way. This is generally mean, but they are defined in this way. And then the variance operator is defined this way too. So this is expectation of given estimates. And then it is indeed nothing but either product of two members in the neural space estimates. So you may, this is variance operator. Things will look a little bit simpler if you know that the random element is mean zero. And this covariance operator, variance operator is nothing but expectation of chronic product. And if you further know that they are finite dimensional, then this chronic product reduces the familiar expectation of the outer product. So this is a variance operator is really an extension, generalization of the finite dimensional variance that we know. Okay? It is, if you know that the random element is finite dimensional with mean zero, and this is really the variance that we know, right? But now, if you have infinite dimensional topic like density, the variance operator will be in like this, okay? If the mean is equal to zero, if mean is not equal to zero, it's more generally defined as this, okay? So that's the mean expectation operator and the variance operator in the function space. Now with that, I'm going to define our norm. Now, for each time, starting from 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and we're going to assume that there's a state distribution that is represented by probability density, so with a subscript t. So at each time period, I have a density, and then that is defined for each ordinate and realign and defined as this. And then I'm going to define wt as a center density. I am not interested in the mean, what I'm interested in is the fluctuations. Deviations from the mean, and I'd like to see whether there's persistency going on. If it's just a random fluctuation, it is okay. But what I'm suspecting from the empirical evidence that I show you, there are serious, drastically obvious persistency going on. So I'm going to work directly with this central density. So whenever I say density, this is the central density I'm talking about. So each time period is defined each time period, just like when you saw, right? Each time period I have densities. Okay. And it is defined. And it is a member of Hilbert space. And space is nothing but a collection of function whose integral is equal to zero and it is square integral. Okay. So my Hilbert space is nothing but the collection of functions that integrates to zero and the square integral. It is well defined. And the inner product is well defined in the usual way. Nothing but integral of the product of this function, right? It's a typical integration for any member living in this. Okay? So we have now, each time period, we have densities and we are looking at the center. Now, well, I'm going to assume that there is, you have a space, and I'm going to say that there's orthonormal basis spinning the Hilbert space. That's what I'm putting in VI. And if you have a basis, and if you know that WT lives in the Hilbert space, you can always represent it as a linear combination of the basis, right? And then when you write something as a linear combination of the basis, there is a coefficient, right? In front of each basis function. That is nothing but, people call that coordinates, and that's nothing but the inner product of the function that you are representing into the basis, and that basis that you're So this is, so WT is, it's our assumption. We assume that it lives in H, the Hilbert space. And I have a VI, a basis spanning, right, the Hilbert space. That means I can represent my W, right, as a linear combination of the basis. Then the linear combination means you have to have a coefficient, right? C1, V1 plus C2, V2 plus, and so on. That C1 is called coordinate process, And C1 is nothing but V1, inner product of V1 and WT. C2 will be inner product of V2 and WT, and so on. So each time, holdings then I'll have a coordinate process. So what I will then for coordinate, since we have a coordinate process at each time period, that gives you one time series. Then you can now talk about whether it has a unit root or not, right? Beforehand, you had functions. Now, coefficient here is going to be a coefficient, just one number, right? Each time you have one number, and then you have time series, and you can talk about whether it has unit root or not. What I'm going to assume that there are m, I don't know what m is, but we're going to learn how to determine m. There will be m, bi's, the basis functions, whose coefficient, the coordinate process, has a unit root. So that n is going to define our unit root subspace. Again, this is very important, let me say it one more time. We are saying that our density is a random element living in the Hilbert space, and then the Hilbert space will have a basis, right? Then you can represent WT, each time period you have a density, that lives in the Hilbert space, meaning that you can represent it as a linear combination of the bases. And then the coefficients on each one of V1, V2, V3 is for coordinate, and then there are C1, C2, C3, and so on. And then we are going to say that if the coordinate process has a unit root, right, then that's going to be, we're going to have that only M of them will have unit root. So, we have infinite number of coefficients, but we'll say the first m, the basis will give me the coefficient that has a unit root. So you can have this for each g, say the first basis function, then you will have a v1, wt, right? And the t, at each time you have this, right? So t1, t2, t1, 2, 3, 4, 5, so for each time you have this coordinate process, right? So it's a one time space. And we'll say that if it's the first one, you have that process as a unit root. Second one, yes. M, yes. But M plus one, no. It's not going to have a unit root. But that's how we define, we bring in. And this is a new framework. You don't have to do this way, but we find it doable if we do this way.
Question is this coefficient on the unit combination C1, C2, etc. Can they also be time ready?
Oh, they are time series.
C1, C2.
C1. So this is going to be C1, T, C2, T, and so on. So C1 is changing over time depending on this. So if I call it, this is going to be. This is going to be CIT.
Okay.
CIT, and the T is changing.
And M is also changing over time.
M does it. M doesn't. It's my assumption. I'm going to have that N is a fixed number. We don't know what it is. We'll use our data to determine. But N is constant.
How do you choose the orthogonal basis?
Right now, we just say there exists one. In the end, for the Fox-Merrill principle component analysis, we're going to use our data, and there will be a sample variance operator, and then we're going to use the eigenvectors. So you can get eigenvalue in the function. If you do functional principal component analysis, which I will talk about in detail a little later. But basically, when it comes to implementation, you have a data, you can get the functional principal component analysis, you get eigenvalues, and then there are eigenvectors associated with your non-zero eigenvalues, and those are, in the end, will be used as the basis. So we are not going to have infinite domain. It will be limited by the number of observations we have, but we do have. Okay, so let me move on, but I just wanted to make clear that what we're doing here. Okay, we have a time series of densities, and we saw obvious persistency, and we want to identify what the sources of the persistences are, right? So as a way to model it, we are introducing this, we are assuming that as a density is a Hilbertian random element. And then I know that we can represent it as a basis functions, and then we say, okay, there are infinitely many, but we not everybody is going to have a universe, but I say there will be some fixed number of the basis which will have this persistent coefficients, coordinates. That's how we decide to model our non-stationarity. Okay? The density is that clear to you? N is equal to zero? So when n is equal to zero, that means there's no basis, right, whose coefficient coordinate will have a neighborhood, then we call that as a stationary. So once you know that, then we can define two subspaces. What's important is this one, non-stationary subspace, which is nothing but the space spent by vi is 1 to m. Remember, first m basis functions are the ones which gave you uniroot coordinate process, right? Once you take the inner product with the density, those first m basis functions, spaces spent by them, we're going to call that as non-stationary subspace. And the space spent by the rest is called stationary subspace. And our underlying neighbor space is nothing but sum of the two. But now, once you have those subspaces, you can define the projections. Okay, you have a, now, we have two tables. So this is a non-stationary subspace, and this is a stationary subspace. And then you can think about projecting onto non-stationary subspace. I'm calling it the pi n, and projection onto stationary subspace, you are, I'm calling it the pi sub s. So then once you have a projection defined, then this is your density, you project it onto the non-stationary subspace, you get density living in the non-stationary subspace. Accordingly, you have a density living in stationary subspace. And they are orthogonal to each other because I'm using orthonormal basis. So now I have started with each time period I have a density. Now with this framework, we can project them, and then we can decompose it, and then they all talk to each other. And that makes things very easy for us to do our entire development. So, of course, we have to develop theory for those, and they are basically, if you define the innovation that generates our density as a generalized linear process, if you guys are familiar with the linear process in finite dimensional time series, this is really the limitation. It looks exactly the same, which is given as infinite sum of past values of the iterations for ut is defined as this. The only difference is that this coefficient here is not a coefficient matrix, moreover. It's a linear operator in this case, because w, these are all infinite dimensional functions. Other than that, everything is the same. We have six sum of the conditions, the rank conditions, and Momo conditions that you use, very similar to what we do in finite dimensional linear process. The boss extended into a generalized stationary case. So again, this is U, the innovation that generates our density, is infinite dimensional because density is. So and because of the epsilons are also infinite dimensional random and living in linear space. So this is what we're going to use. And once you have this, we can actually decompose the innovation just like the Beverly Nelson decomposition that is used by Phillips and Solow, which is also called Phillips and Solow device. So once you do this, actually the innovation has two components. And the second term is actually differential of very well-defined stationary process. So you can see that this is going to be needless regular, and you have a leading term. So this use, under our assumption here, this is well-defined stationary process, and here we're looking at differential of stationary, so you can see that this one is going to be dominating this guy. And once that is done, then you can see that our density projected on the non-stationary subspace is indeed the uniroot process, because you have integrated, this is an integrating process.
So it has a uniroot.
Whereas the density projected on the stationary subspace is really by the stationary process.
So now we have a density.
So we can now clearly see that density projected onto the non-stationary subspace is I1 process.
whereas this is very important. And as I said, we don't know what M is. We needed to know M to define properly define our non-stationary subspace, but we don't. But we will, in practice, we don't. So later on, I will show you how we may determine statistically what M is. And once you estimate M, you can define non-stationary subspace accordingly. Right? If you know the dimension of the M, and then you can choose based on what will happen at the end of the day. If M is 2, then you will have a sample variance. You will do the principal component, functional principal component analysis on the sample variance operator, and you will have eigenvalues. You will take the two largest eigenvalues and take the corresponding eigenvectors. That's going to be the vector spinning will define your non-stationary subspace in implementations. And once you have that, then if you know the basis, right, spanning the non-stationary subspace, you can do things. And those are the ones that will characterize our persistences. And you will show, our, at least I'll show you one measure that you can develop to see how persistent various functions are, I say, mean function, various function, and so on. And of course, the non-stationary part, especially the density in the non-stationary subspaces, has a unit root. And of course, you will have to do limit theory. For functional limit theories, you have to draw your motion. And Brownian motion is defined naturally. It is the guy living in the non-stationary subspace satisfying this condition. So if you take a part of this guy, for anyone living in non-stationary subspace, it's going to be a Brownian motion with a various uniquenesses. It's natural. And then if you have a sequence of such a Brownian motion and the process, something like this, then you can actually have invariance principle going on that goes as long as this one, the DCM product converges to this. A little bit of modification by this and the other problem which will be fine with this type of analysis. But you can also look back to run it this too. So you have you can also define your covariance matrix where each element is defined as this, and then invariance principle can also go through the spectrum. And this functional limit theory, invariance principle, will be into our analysis. Okay, now we're going to get there by doing functional principle command analysis on this sample variance operator. Of course, we can approach it if we have the end over our sample ends. And then this is again the density. For now, as I said, we're going to assume that I know the density. And as I said, we'll talk about explicitly what happens if we don't and we have to estimate. But for now, we know density, but we are limited by our sample size. So we're looking at instead of variance operator, we look at with subscript t including the sample size, sample variance operator. And then you do, you can get the eigenvalues and their associated eigenvectors and look at them as a pair. First one, the largest one, and then you write them accordingly, as you do usually. Then and then the, now, center universe space is now defined as a space spent by the eigenvectors associated m largest eigenvalues, right? I rank the eigenvalues and I gave numbers on the particular parts. The first one is the largest. So m, if you, I don't know what m is, but suppose we know m now, because the study only contributed. The first m, right? The eigenvectors are the eigenvectors associated with the m largest eigenvalues of sample variance operator. This is how we define sample universe space. And then accordingly, you can define stationary subspace accordingly. Because you just have to use the relationship. Sum of the two has to be equal to 1 million. And then the pi again is representing projection. Okay? So when you have projections here onto the non-stationary sample universe space, and then this is the projection of the sample stationary subspace, and we show that actually this is original projection onto the universe subspace, and this is a sample, and then we show that they are consistent. So using sample universe subspace is fine when you are defining projections. Okay, this is projection onto Sample in your space, and this is projection of the original non-stationary subspace. Projection is fine. They are consistent. You can use this. Now, to analyze our secondary sample area. So this one is until 11:30, right? So we decompose this. So this is a secondary sample area in non-stationary direction, stationary direction, and this is the edge wave, which is not really matter for our S9 analysis. But I like to stress that the secondary is in the non-stationary direction. They have been detected, you have seen, so they are heavier. So you need larger, you need heavier normalization here, T square. And on the other hand, the sample variance operator in the stationary direction, they are lighter, so you need only T to normalize it. And this one is actually very important. There is a differential, the difference in the normalizations. So here, now, this is a non-stationary T. The sample variance operator in the non-stationary T direction, and you know that we normalize by T square, they converge in distribution to this random operator in the limit, and represented by the functionals of Brownian motion with this variance operator. On the other hand, in the stationary subspace, again, this thing was only normalized by T, right, not T square. They converge in probability, not distribution, to the population counterpart, which is given as this. So key difference, this was normalized by T-square and converging in distribution to random operator defined with Brownian motion. Whereas in stationary subspace, the sample variance operator is normalized with T only, and it converges in probability to its population counterpart. And that is our reciprocity theory, and this is a summary of what I just said. And then we can also talk about, these are the limits of sample variance operator in the non-stationary direction. We can have, and we can talk about eigenvalues and eigenvectors of them, and we can rank them. And of course, because these guys are random, the eigenvalues are also random. But what we show is that they are random, but still they span the non-stationary subspace. So that's the important message here. But what's happening in the stationary subspace, so these are eigenvalues of this is the limit of the sample variance operator in the stationary direction. You can also rank them. But because this is a limit of stationary process, this is well known to be positive, semi-definite, and nuclear, meaning that all the eigenvalues, if you rank them, they're all non-negative, and they're summed to be positive. Well, their sum is finite, well-defined, which has very important implication, meaning that the eigenvalues of this stationary limit is approaching to zero as I gets large. So that's very important. So if you are in the stationary subdirectional space, eigenvalues will be very small. Maybe not at the beginning, but as I gets large, it's going to be, and indeed the limit is in the spectrum. Limit point of the spectrum is actually equal to zero. So now this is eigenvalues and eigenvectors of a sample variance operator. In the non-stationary direction where you have I 1 to n, remember I is index for base. If you go up to n, the eigenvalues converge, you have to normalize by T square, which is obvious from what we have seen. And then they converge in distribution to their counterparts. The eigenvalue and eigenvectors of its limit operator. On the other hand, in the stationary case where the n is greater than, the index is greater than m plus 1, m plus 2, and so on, you need only T normalization, and they converge in probability to their eigenvalues and eigenvectors of their variable and the limit. So this one, I'm emphasizing again, there's a difference in the convergence rate of these eigenvalues. So we are going to use that information to test what's going to be the end. Okay, we're going to exploit that. But obviously, there are other ways of testing. I mean, if you want to test what the end is, you can do something like this. You can look at this type of objective function and use the penalty terms like this, like Cheng and Phillips did recently. And this kind of procedure, if you
pick the M as something that minimizes objective function, then as they show with coupling one, you can find
2M.
This is one way that you can do. But however, in this paper, I'm going to follow the conventional sequential type of approach that you have seen in Johansson's type, used for point rank, determining rank of the point durations. But here, we are going to use the same sequential testing approach, but none of the things that was developed earlier in point duration literature is not applicable here, because there, their object is finite dimensional vectors. But here, we have infinite dimensional. So although we are following in spirit testing scheme, but their procedure is none of them are applicable here. So we have to develop a new one. And again, so this is the setup. As I said, we're going to be doing sequential testing starting from some big M, some MX, reasonable. For our case, unit root space is not that big. M equals 5 does reasonably good job. So you can imagine that M max is 5. So you start from hypothesize that the unit root dimension is 5. If you exactly go down to 4 and test whether it's 4, if you reject, go down to 3. And then if it's rejected, go down to 2. And if you cannot reject anymore, that is going to be your unit root dimension. And obviously, it's well known that as long as you apply consistent test at each step of the way, with probability 1, you will find the correct one. So this is our testing principle. And then I've been emphasizing many times that the eigenvalues of the second derivative operator has different the normalization factor, right? If you are in the unit root subspace, you have to need, you need t square. If you are in the stationary t, you only need t. So obviously, so you can consider intuitively this is very clear. Okay, I don't know what m is, right? M could be true m could be 3, right? Then you said actually m is only so when 2 unit root was m, I'm 3, but then you were testing whether m is only equal to 2, for instance. Actually, you said that true was only 2 because we were doing sequential. True was 2, but you said you were testing whether m equal to 3, for instance, right? Then, what's going to happen, but since I don't know whether it is true or not, why don't I just normalize by t squared? Then I know that if it's indeed in the unit root subspace, then you did the right thing, right? Because you need t squared to have a non-trivial limit, right? Remember, if you normalize by t squared, it converges to the eigenvalues of the some operator, right? The limit. But if it was not in the unit root subspace, and if it was in stationary t indeed, then you are normalizing too heavily, right? You only need t, but you are normalizing t squared. That means no matter what you have, it's going to go to zero, right? As t gets large. So this is basically the idea. I don't know what that is, right? I may be pinning down the correct one or not. But if I didn't, I don't know why this is going wrong so quickly. So why don't we just normalize by t squared? And then my test will tell whether this guy is, you know, whether this guy was in the stationary direction. So if this is too small, if this test statistic is too small, that means I overdid it, right? I overanalyzed. So this is going to be a very good way to tell whether or not, but this intuitive test is infeasible because this limit, the limit theory you can find, but it depends on all kinds of, it depends on nuisance parameters, so it's not usable, okay? This is very intuitive, but the limit theory depends on nuisance parameters, making it not usable. So we're going to have to find another way of doing it. So what we do is actually, we're going to reduce the problems. Instead of looking at entire thing, we're going to look at only M. So what I would do is, so given you each time period, you have densities, right? And you look at the inner product of this density with first M, because M is the number that you're proposing. You're claiming M to be 5, say, right? Then you have 5 eigenvectors, right? Of your sample variance operator. Each time period you take the inner product of your density, then there will be one random variable to an m. So it's going to be n by one vector. Then you can easily look at their sample moments, right? Which is not nothing but n by m matrix now. And I'm going to call that this as a variance in the universe subspace. So this is going to be n by m matrix now. And this is going to be what I call variance in the universe subspace, universe space. Then you can apply, and this is under the norm, they are all univood, Hazard univood. Therefore, you need T-square normalization and your convergent distribution to integrate our product of our dimension. But now this is vector Brownian motion, m-dimensional, so this is going to be m by n matrix of Brownian motions. Right? And then this one is Brownian motion with omega m, the variance. And of course, I don't know, but I can consistently estimate them. And then once you know the consistent estimate of this, then what I will do is I will consider generalized eigenvalue of this is the variance in the universe subspace with respect to the consistent estimator of the various matrix of the Brownian motion appearing in the limit. So what I show in the paper is that actually these generalized eigenvalues of this second variance operator with respect to normal variance estimator converges at this rate to the eigenvalues and eigenvectors of the limits. Okay, this is Qn, the limit of this guy, and then the omega is the variance of this guy. So we have this limit theory, and okay? What's important to know is that we do have safety, but the only problem is the limit contains nuisance parameter, which is the variance. So, but I told you that I need a new procedure because I don't want to deal with the nuisance parameter of that very intuitive test. So what we do, I get rid of it. I standardize it by pre-multiplying by this, and then you can get the eigenvalues. Now, once you standardize, then this guy has identity matrix, right? This is the vector, standard vector of Brownian motion, so there's no variance to worry about. So you can just look at use your eigenvalues and eigenvectors, and then this one is going to be the limit to be defined with this one, normalized eigenvalues. Okay? So therefore what we can show, you can easily show that actually generalized eigenvalue of the Qm with respect to omega is nothing but the regular, the usual eigenvalue of this Qm. Is defined with the standardized Brownian motion. So, in particular, what we have is this good thing. If you have a generalized eigenvalue of a central variance operator in the universe space with respect to the consistent estimator of this normal variance, is actually converting in distribution to the usual variance eigenvalue of something. Right, this integrated outer product of normalized standard, right? This is normalized, so this is standard vector Brownian motion, n-dimensional. So there's no nuisance parameters there anymore. Okay? So now this eigenvalue is something that we can think about using in test statistics because it converges to the distribution of the eigenvalues of something that we don't have to worry about the nuisance parameters. Of course it depends on m, but this, once you know m, this one you can easily simulate, right? You can simulate Brownian motions by simulating partial sums of ID normals, right? The Brownian motions. Brownian increments are normals, right? So you can easily simulate it. So this is really the basis of our theory. So now we're almost there. So what we're going to do is right now, beforehand I was just looking at any the basis. Now we can look at the eigen, particularly the eigenvector of our equation, the sample variance operator, m of them. Then now it becomes feasible, but still, then this is the m dimension. The only difference is that now I'm using not any v, but in particular the eigenvectors of the sample variance operator. Then you have this. Then you can estimate now how much the variance of the Brownian motion. And there comes our test. If this is nuisance parameter test, free. So this is the m. M is going to be smallest one. is n, right? Because we're ranking them, so the largest one comes first, and the last one is n. So this is the smallest generalized eigenvalue on the set, the second variance. The variance operated in Euler subspace with respect to the system estimate of the local variance that I just defined, and then normalized by t. And under the norm, if n, under when n is true, then it's going to converge, the distribution of this t statistic will converge to the distribution of the smallest eigenvalue of q star n, which is the integrated product form of n dimensional vector, standard vector of Brownian function. And then under the alternative, it's going to converge in probability to zero. The main reason for consistency is, again, because we are normalized by t-square, and in the stationary, under the alternative of stationarity, we're normalizing to heavily, so therefore we're going to have to have zero. Okay? So therefore, what we're doing is we're sequentially applying consistent tests, therefore with probability one, we'll identify true dimensional unit subspace. So what you can do with that, now we learn how to estimate n. Once you do that, actually, you can do something more interesting. But before I get there, let me extend our Hilbert space to include any square integral. Earlier, we have to have a mean zero functions, but many times, functions, as long as they're square integral, you're okay not to have a mean zero. As long as you define them as this, you take away mean. And then the norm of that kind of norm of that function in the extended Hilbert space is now defined as this. And then again, the norm square is defined as nothing but some of the coefficient squares, right? This is where it comes. Now, once you have that, then we can analyze unit proportions of various functions. Let's first talk about the functions that generate mean and the moments, right? For the polynomials, one will be generated more. Mean, two, variance, third, so on. So this is moment functions. And if you take the inner product of the moment function with the center density, then you get this. Basically, you get the random fluctuation. This represents random fluctuations around the mean. Okay? So now the norm sphere is nothing but the norm of the function selected of the non-stationary subspace plus, because they all orthogonal to each other. And then this one is a norm of that function projected on the stationary subspace, and they are nothing but given as this, right? So the non-stationary space is spent by first e and b's, right? That gives you this, and the rest will give you stationary components. So now, then I'm going to define, so what I define as a unit proportion of the functions, normal functions. In the denominator, you put the entire norm. And on top, you put the norm of the function that falls into non-stationary subspace. So it gives you very nice ratio. So the ratio, if the function mu, the say mean function, falls mostly into non-stationarity, then this ratio will be very close to 1. But if it's very little bit of it is falling into non-stationary subspace, mu will be close to 0. So this is going to be a measure of persistency of your mean function. And once you have a mean function, then you, I call that as mean because if you have x identity function, x, then f of x is mean, right? So you can get mean, and you can get second moment, x squared by f of x will give you second moments and so on. So you can find out the proportion, unit root proportion in each. That's why later on I'll be able to say, okay, 50% of the mean function falls into non-stationarity, so therefore it is pretty persistent. But you may have only 5%, then it's not that persistent, something like that you can say. Okay, if that was a mean, what about the volatility? How much of the volatility? How persistent that is? Then instead of you can vaguely say things by looking at graph, you can actually appear this is a measure, and it says how much. Between 0 to 1 scale, right? So that's, and then of course you can, if you are restricted to the particular sample, the V's are going to be the basis, instead of any arbitrary base, you can use eigenvectors of your sample variance operator. And then you can, I can show that actually using eigenvectors of our sample variance operator is consistent.
Okay, now what happens with if you have a, you have to estimate density. And I will go through very quick so that we have time for an empirical illustration. So basically, I don't know f, so I have to use an estimated density. And I don't know the mean, so I'm going to have to take the second mean times this mean, like this mean of estimated density. And I can tell you that as long as you have enough observation to estimate function, density function in each time period, what you're going to be doing will have any effect in our theory. But using the second mean of estimated density instead of true mean will have an impact. But it's not major. I will show you. So using estimated density over here doesn't have anything. But using the mean of estimated density will have an impact. It's not going to do anything to stationary case, but it's going to do something to non-stationary subspace, I'll show you. So I'm going to just point out what's happening and then I'll move on. So of course you need to have some, you know, the regular conditions. So everything the same, you look at now estimating the various operator. So everything the same except that you have hats, right? And all the things that we have done, so therefore the estimated non-stationary subspace will now be a space spent by the eigenvectors of the estimated variance operator corresponding to n largest eigenvalues. Everything looks exactly the same except that now we have underbar. In the stationary case, nothing changes. But in non-stationary case, instead of w, we have w bar. W was Brownian motion. Now we have a d mean Brownian motion. So that is the only impact of having to estimate the density with, because you don't know. But this is really minor. But then that, but you can do everything as exactly the same. The limit theory, convergence rate in particular, they are the same. You can estimate the feasible nuisance free test now using eigenvectors corresponding to n largest eigenvalues of estimated separators operator. Then you can define variance in the universe subspace, like this is the n by n matrix, and the limit theory will be exactly the same. Except for the fact that you will have W bar instead of W. And then our case statistics is going to be now generalized eigenvalue, smallest generalized eigenvalue of the central variance operator, I mean the variance operator in the universe subspace with respect to the consistent estimate of the variance. Okay, as we have seen. Then here, what's happening is that instead of W star, we have W bar. And everything. Again, this is the same except for the fact that now it's you still have a standard vector around in motion, but you have to take away the mean, okay? The mean. Then everything else is the same. So the under the norm, it converges to the distribution of the smallest eigenvalue of this. Now this is integrated product moment of center, the mean, the vector around in motions under the norm, but under the alternative of the stationarity, this will converge into zero. By the same thing. So now once you have, actually you can simulate the critical value, and this is the simulated critical values. Again, Q underbar n is mean. Once you know, once you generate the vector grounding motion, right? Just each can be approximated by standardized partial sum of mean GYID process, and then you can easily simulate the percentile, 1, 5, and 10%, and these are critical values. As you can see, as n gets large, right, as n gets large, the critical values are getting smaller, obviously, because n represents the smallest generalized eigenvalue. Our smallest eigenvalue, of course. But our test statistic is given as a generalized, let me emphasize one more time. Our test statistic is defined as a smallest generalized eigenvalue of the estimated variance in the universe, but the critical values, of course, is going to be usual eigenvalue of this one. Okay? And that one is given by this n-dimensional standard vector parameter d mean. Okay? So once you estimate n star, n hat, we know how to estimate m now, then you can estimate the uniloop proportion using estimates m, right? So in the denominator, you have an entire thing of a square root covariance, but upstairs, you only have up to whatever you need to make sure.
Now, empirical representations, I'm going to give you two empirical, as I said earlier. One is the time series of input distribution, the other one is the time series of intra-period, the stock input distributions. And then we're going to estimate the densities each time period using Gaussian color and non-parametric estimation. And then we'll construct the, our test as a generalized eigenvalues. And then we'll add maximum. We're going to start from m=5 and then go down sequentially, estimate the m, say 2 or 1, whatever. And then accordingly, we can estimate the linear proportions. Okay? And of course, we cannot deal with the infinite dimensional plane, so we have to represent it as a finite dimensional vector, and we'll do so by using Hobbitz's spherical basis. And it comes out to be nice for our case because our density, as you saw, we have time varying support, and so we have a very serious amount of asymmetric. So it comes out to work better than the trigonometric basis. So we chose to work with the closed basis with the 1,000 Hertz basis. So you can imagine now your density is like a long vector, 1,000 Hertz dimensional vector. Now, the first example, the cross-sectional distributions, so basically this one is what the time series of ON is. So we use the data from current population survey. So what they have, each month they have individual weekly earnings. Individual weekly earnings. And that is the, but then they're the, everything is inflated by a consumer price index with the base year 2005. So we therefore have a 204 monthly series starting from December of January 94 to December 2010. And each month actually we get quite a few observations ranging over 12,000 to 15,000. So I think we have plenty of observations to estimate accurately each month's earnings. And one thing to note is that for the confidentiality reasons, the individual earnings that are too high are calculated. So it is sensors to be dropped then, as most of the people in income dynamics literature do. And then the individual earnings reported as zero, we're not considering that either. But so that, from that, right, January 94 to December 2008, this is the income distribution changing. And if you take the DME, you estimate, get the average of time average of these densities and then the DB central density, and this is what you have seen over here. Here, obviously, there are persistences going on, and we're going to analyze what kind of persistence, what characteristics of distribution is really giving you this type of persistence that we see right now. What aspects of the distribution? So we do that. And then we use our test, let's first determine what's in your good dimension, and this is our test statistics. Again, this is the generalized eigenvalue. As you can see, remember we are rejecting the null if it's too small, because we are normalizing as though it is uniform. So we are normalizing too heavy. So if you were in this stationary, then you would be very close to zero, indeed. And you can see that our test says n equal to 2. Which is pretty obvious if you look at screen plots, there's a really obvious drop too. So, yeah. And then once you know n equal to 2, then you can estimate the uniloop proportion for the mean, first moment, second moment, third moment, fourth moment. And it says that there are substantial amount of persistence for uniloop proportion is substantial. First moment is more than 50%. Second moment 34, third 44, they're all. So you can see that the non-stationarity and the persistence we saw probably is very well represented by first four moments. And what's particularly interesting is the second, the unit proportion in the second moment, because this is very consistent with what's been reported in income dynamics literature. Because those people who are studying income inequalities or disparities, they just look at the snapshot of income distributions across many, several year period, and they saw the variance was increasing. And they say that the income disparities, if they were there, they tend to be there, increasing, meaning that income inequality, if you have this now, policymakers may want to see it decreasing, but that's not what they see. They see more persistency. So all they can say is that it's not going to be smaller, it can
when they get larger, the indicating further income disparities going on. So I find that very intriguing. Now, instead of looking at that kind of, you know, snapshot analysis several years at a time, every 10 years or something, you can actually have the time series of income distribution at every month, and you can actually calculate the moments and represent this. And that is much more, to me, intelligent way of saying how the persistent, the income disparity will behave next year. Because persistency is obviously a problem. It gives us a problem, right? They break things down, the conventional social labor theory, large numbers may not apply in the extreme cases, but it also gives us opportunity in terms of forecasting, right? It's a predictable, with the prediction part comes from the dependencies. And then the other example is the intra-month distribution. Again, what we're doing is basically this kind of picture. So what we do here is we get the 1 minute tick data from, we got it from tick corporations of the S&P 500. So what we do is we look at we start from the 7th of January 92 to June of 2010. So each month you go in, you collect the 1 minute data, there are quite a few, and they range from 7211 to 9177, except for the September 11th, the month of September 11th, where we only have 5,900, which is still quite a lot. So we have enough to estimate individual densities for each month. So we use 1 minute data to estimate intra-month, I call intra-month, the stock market distributions. And you may wonder that 1 minute data might be contaminated with the micro-contamination noise. So we also tried with 5 minutes, which is often considered a safe zone, but we didn't see any difference. So I think perhaps because we're using wavelet basis, which is pretty robust, we didn't see any issues. But anyway, this is the intra-month stock market distribution over time. Obviously, it's time changing, right? It peaks drastically different, and actually you see it is even more clear if you look at the centered density, the location of the peak changes drastically too. Okay, obviously persistent, let's understand. So we estimate them using our statistics, and this is the test statistics. So we are going to test sequentially for 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, and we can represent 1. So we estimate M to be 1, and which is also obviously supported by our spring plot. And then once I know that, then we can compute the unit proportion across 4 moments. And I don't know whether you remember the number, this is substantially smaller than what you have seen, right? In income, we talk about 52, 34, 20 something, but it is the first moment. They're very, very close to zero. I mean, compare the first and the third moment. The second and the fourth moment are larger, but still it's only 8 something and the 2 something percentage. I mean, I think it is true that the volatility and kurtosis are more persistent, but not nearly as persistent as what we have seen in income. I think they indicate 2 things. Maybe first 4 moments are just not enough to understand all the persistence is going on, or moments are maybe not, you should look at something other than moments, some other population characteristics of the distribution you should be looking at to really understand where the persistence is coming from.
Look at graphs before from the dimming series. Perhaps there are 2 regimes, one is peak rise, one is post rise, and that perhaps this proportions would change.
I think you're clearly right. There are much less persistence going on here than this. But there might have been some kind of regime changes.
Did you try to fit over these 2 sub-samples and compute this proportion?
So you think we might have more units over here and less over there? Could be, but I didn't because our sample is only about 222. So I didn't, as I show you in the simulation, we have to have about 200 to get reasonable finite sample performances. So I didn't break it, but certainly by looking at this, that's something that you can think
of. Perhaps that will change to weekly frequency. To change it to weekly frequency,
But we also remember we have to estimate density, and you want to make sure that you have planning. And then going to
I know we have even more high frequency data, but market microstructure noise is there too. So we figured the 1 minute was pretty reasonable. 5 minutes people say, but as I said, I compared the two. So given this, maybe when we have a longer time,
one
we can do something.
5 minutes would give more persistence, I guess, in the process, and the 5 minute sample would
average out. But actually, in our laboratory, we didn't see any noticeable change between 1 and 5. But those are also considered. The longer the period you have with them, they're less. Okay, so that's what we have found. I found it very interesting. And then the simulations, I mean, basically what we do is we simulate using the part, we wanted to come up with a simulation model that's more realistic. So what we use, so we consider two simulation setups, one and the one setup coming from our income distribution analysis, empirical distribution, and second setup from our stock with the intra-period study. So we're going to use the eigenvectors, right? The eigenvectors of the sample variance, fit the sample variance operator from these two applications. That's going to be, I'm going to use that as a basis. And then, of course, I have to generate the density. I need the coefficients, right, for the process. And then I will generate them accordingly. So here is what I do. So basically, for our simulation, I have to generate density. So I mean, for V, I'm going to get that from our empirical analysis, one individual one is a stock inference, but then I have to generate these coefficients, and how I do is M0 is going to be 2 for individual earnings distribution and 1 for stock inference, and then if you are in that case, then you I equals 1, and then the, if not, you are in here, and then it's going to be stationary. And then we use actually, and we also have a coordinate process obtained in two different empirical processes, and I use them to fit those coefficients. And then, those are the parameters that we get. Even the variances, they're all from our empirical analysis. So you have this generated for two different cases. So first of all, I mean, because so here and now is 2. And T, 204. So basically, we only have 204 eigenvectors, but I will use that to generate our sample. Right? And then this is the sample sizes, the rejection probabilities. So 2 is equal to 2. So this is where you should look at for size. And this one is power, right? You are rejecting when n is not equal to 2. So these are. But as you can see, this is really the size. The size is really good, especially when sample size is not that big, that is under rejecting. But as long as you get, that's why I said I have a minimum of 200, we're pretty good. In terms of power, unless your M is too far away, too bigger, too much bigger than what the truth is, and when sample size is small, you have a problem. But as long as your sample size increases, they're doing very well. Okay? And then here now, of course, it depends, it's a union group test, so it depends on the alpha, how far you are away from union group. So I try different values of alpha. So the farther away you are from 1, the more power you're going to get, that's obvious, right? But even when the alpha is very close to 1, we have very good power when sample size is large. But the so similar thing happens, so let me move on and look at the second simulation. Here, 2 number in unit 1. We have a sample size 222, so I only have 222 basis function to play with. And then that's how I define my W's. And then this is rejection probabilities. Again, 2 is 1. So here, this column represents the size. But in this example, even when sample size is equal to 100, size is really good. But the power is compromised. And that's why if M true, right, when the your claim hypothesize N is too different from 2, and sample size is not big, your power is not good at all. That's why I suggest that you have to have at least 200, then your size and power are reasonably good.
over here, how, you know, also this departure from the non-unihood, even when you are very close to the unihood, you are very close to, as long as your sample size are larger. But if you are far away from, like this, even for sample size, you have very good power. Okay? So before, I mean, so let me conclude. I mean, this is a summary. I think our test was really well in terms of finite sample size and powers. But the only time the test doesn't have good power is when you're when you are testing something that is too far, too much bigger than the true, and your sample size small. But as long as you're prepared to use samples of size bigger than 200, you don't have a problem. So let me quickly conclude. So basically, we see these time-changing patterns of densities. And certainly we saw obvious persistence going on. And our intention was to understand where the what's the characteristic or property, what are the characteristics of the distribution that is creating, giving us the persistence patterns we see. So we wanted to identify what those are and estimate them and then do interesting inference. So to do that, we have to consider density as a random element living in Hilbert space. We're providing some structures, and then we use the functional principle component analysis, right? So that we can look at eigenvalues and eigenvectors of a sample variance operator, and then the eigenvectors associated with the M largest eigenvalues that gave us the variance in the universe subspace, and then generalize eigenvalue of that, normalized by T squared, was the test statistics. And we show that it is a nuisance parameter test, and it is converging in distribution to eigenvalues of something that is nuisance parameter free, which we could easily simulate. And under the alternative, it was consistent. Therefore, doing sequential testing was completely fine, because we know that in that case, with probability 1, we'll identify true n. And once you know the uniroot dimension, you can do and that gave us a very interesting way of measuring how persistent certain things, right? Certain aspects of the distribution. We saw mean, variance, kurtosis, and so on. The last one is actually, I only have 3 minutes, but this is not part of the paper, but this is a paper that I'm working on now. The wizards are very fun, so I'll introduce you. So I look at the data, the temperature data, collected from England, actually, UK Met Office. What I have is actually, I have a globe, I have a temperature data collected over 5 by 5 cell. It is collected monthly. So each month you have how many? So we have each month, like this many, right? You have this many 5 by 5 reads. And then you have 12 months. So every year I have this many, potentially I can get that many observations. Because I have this many cells, and then you have 12 months. And also, the temperature that these guys are giving is not the original temperature, but this is deviation from the period. So they first compute the average temperature in this 30-year time period, 1961 to 1990, and then the observation on other years, it starts from 850, they are measured as a deviation, and they call that as a temperature anomalies. And those are the data that I'm working with. So number of observations, potentially you can get this many, but of course we cannot get that many all the time. And there you can see they're constantly increasing, but these two drops are World War I and World War II, but other than that. And this is the total number of observations globally in the northern hemisphere and southern hemisphere. Okay. Those are the number of observations you have. And then this is a time series, so this is for global, okay, from 1850. And you have, these are annual. Every year you have 1850 to now. And then this is a center, and you clearly see persistences, right? This is no way you can say this is random fluctuations. And then you see, for fun, I use this, I have density every period. I can use each period, I can compute mean, variance, kurtosis, right? Each period that I have density, so I can compute those four things. Mean, variance, skewness, and kurtosis. And this is time series from 1850 to 2010. So mean, you see some increasing pattern. Variance a little bit down. But again, this is global skewness, not too much pattern. But kurtosis is slightly increasing. But if you look at the northern hemisphere, this is more varying, and then you can see them. And you see a little bit more obvious patterns of upward trend in mean, but variance coming down more obvious. And skewness is even more stationary, but kurtosis is going up a little bit. And this is sudden has a tendency. Actually, southern part, you have to remember there have a lot more water than northern. And then this is the mean. And the mean, by variance, you can see they're much lower. Because of, I think, they have more water. But skewness, a little bit down, kurtosis is a little bit up, but not much. But now, if we are going to apply our test statistics to northern, southern, and lower. And we'll do hypothesis starting from M, and then sequentially going down, and then applying the same testing procedure. And this is the critical values that we have seen earlier. But I also look at, so this is a critical value of testing univood against the stationarity. But I also came up with critical values of testing univood against the explosive or deterministically growing. So I can test two ways. Okay. You can say that this is not stationary. Okay, it doesn't come back to the mean right away. That means there is a trend, stochastic trend. But people may wonder, do you just have a trend which will eventually come down? Or do you really have a growth pattern, deterministically or explosively? So it's interesting to test both. So we simulate critical values for the other end. So you basically have a distribution. You're either looking at the lower end or the upper end. So these are two sections of quantiles, 1, 5, 10, 1, 5, the other side. For the globe, the turned out to be n equal to 2. Right? So this is M2, this is not smaller than critical value, and this is not greater than the critical value. Because here, we reject an R if it's smaller than critical value. Here, you reject an R if you're greater than. And here, if it's N2, you're not smaller than critical value at the top, not greater. So it's M2. And then the univood proportion, then you can compute the critical values. Once you have the determined n, then you can compute the univood proportion. And this is the first 7 moments that you have computed for the entire globe. And you can do the same exercise for northern. And again, northern turns out to be 2. But there, you can see the univood proportions are different. It's slightly less, but in other cases. But if you look at the southern area, you can see that it's even higher. Remember, globe it was 51%, northern 40. I'm just looking at the first moment, and here 63%. And here, interestingly, there's only one univood proportion, but the univood proportions are although the different. I mean, this is the paper is not done, but I think I was very happy because I don't have to take a stance that's not politically incorrect because I'm not saying that there's no global warming. I said there's a stochastic trend. So if you think that you're growing, temperature is increasing, what I'm saying is that you're more likely than not, next period will be on the growing path. But I'm also saying, but on the other hand, although I have that stochastic trend, I also tested against the deterministic growing path that some people really worry about or explosive. But I'm saying that no, it's not the case. Okay, it's not going back to whatever mean, but it is really stochastic. It may take a while, maybe longer than what you wish, but it will come down. So I think it's pretty neutral, but I think that you can do a lot more because we are trying to do more. Because now that we have a time series of density, you can really look at, I mean, lack of any better ideas, I just look at first 7 moments. Why do you have to just look at moments? You can look at any other character. You have a density, then you can come up with anything else that you have. You can look at the lower quartile, like the VAR, bar types, or something else. But I am curious to see, I mean, for you, maybe you can come up with a creative way of using these densities and see. You can come up, I think it's a matter of exercise of finding the function. I just look at polynomials, right? Moment functions. S power 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, but that function could be more general. And I mean, if you can find some function that really captures a lot of univood proportion, and maybe close to 1, I think that's a very important. I think in southern hemisphere case, we have 63%. First moment is capturing 60, I mean, it's having 63%. 3% of linear group, which is informed of linear group. Okay, so I will finish.
Resume shifting happening there, And now we know what between shiftings are when you have this usual random variable. But now we have to, maybe we have to come up with a new framework to analyze region shifting in infinite dimensional objects.
Yeah, yeah. So
which is
the simplest. So region switching is the simplest way to analyze windows, so which you basically break it up into two windows and then localize it. Yeah, and then maybe you can come up with other generalized ways to localize it. But maybe it's a
I think that picture as you pointed out, you see clearly, and then I think in that period it didn't really coincide, but in terms of financial markets, correlation among different financial markets, before and after the financial crisis in 2007, the different markets around the globe, they start integrating, or correlation between different stock markets are much bigger. They're to the point close, very close to one, but before that point it was very low. So many people are viewing that there's a also structure, region shifting happening. So, but in the picture that you were looking at, it was not really around 2007. So I think
it was
earlier than, so maybe it was around the Iraq something. So anyway, that was a big, good point to think about.
And also at the point, so you're showing like the compensation proportion for the moments, all kinds of moments, is that okay, because there are so many research going on in this into a quantiles, can you also possibly analyze the decomposition proportion of non-stationary from the quantile changing moments to quantiles? Is that possible?
Oh, instead of a moment, then you will have to get whatever quantile they have in mind.
Yeah, you can do whatever.
Yeah, because anything you can do with density, you can do here.
Yeah. So then because you were saying like you don't see too much decomposition of non-stationary at the moment, then maybe you can also show in your report about how much of the quantiles, kind of the quantiles, that it shows more that at what level that the non-stationary to decomposition comes in. I guess.
I think so, that's one way. Quantiles.
Yeah, it's
just
a better way to present your thoughts, I guess.
Is this the moment that presented in quantiles to you?
Yeah, because you were saying like you don't see so many. You don't see, I think in the previous.
Oh,
you make a point saying like you don't see so many the stationarity in the moment. There must be something else happening with the distribution.
Right.
Maybe you can only show with the quantiles and maybe you see something.
Yeah. Yeah, so certainly this paper is already in the review and submitted, but some of you guys can try. So this is again a paper that introduced new framework, and a lot of it is going to be the interested users or readers can go. And we wanted to illustrate at least few ways of using this methodology so that since it's so new, we felt very obliged to introduce some way of applications. But obviously, it's only very few that we could think of at the time. Yeah.
Okay, so I think that's enough.